이번에 주제는 불평등 그 현재와 미래입니다.
In spite of rising inequality, we have not seen so far the kind of political response to rising inequalities that you could expect to see, in particular in Western countries. And I will stress three factors. You know, certainly rise of globalization and in particular the migration cleavage, you know, has created a new tension within the electorate in Europe, also in the US, in the particular US the racial context. But I will argue that the rise of higher education has been probably an even more important factor. So here the idea is that as long as you are in the era of primary and secondary education, there's a very simple egalitarian platform, which is simply when you want to get everybody, you know, 100% of a generation at the top of primary school and then at the top of secondary school. With higher education, it's more complicated because you cannot have as a policy platform the objective of getting 100% of a generation right to the PhD, or at least not in the foreseeable future. So you have to design a policy platform that sort of tolerates some level of persistent educational stratification and at the same time helps the more disadvantaged group at least as much as those who have already succeeded in higher education. And I think this has been a major challenge for what used to be left-wing parties in the post-World War II era, and I would argue this is in the end what have made them being sort of less and less appealing to the socially disadvantaged electorate. And finally, change in global ideology, especially following the fall of communism, I think has been an even more important factor, and is also probably the most important factor for the future, which also means that new change in global ideology can also make a difference. We are not going to rewrite history, but the point is that at the end of the day, in the middle of the 20th century, you had a huge increase in progressive taxation. So if you take the US federal income tax, between 1930 and 1980, so during half a century, on average, the top income tax rate was 82%. Okay? So sometimes it was 91, sometimes it was 70. If you make the average over half a century, it was 82. And this was only the federal income tax. You also had the state income tax in New York, Texas, it could be 5-10%, the top of that. Okay? Now, apparently, this did not destroy American capitalism, you know, otherwise we would have noticed it. And if anything, productivity growth rate were actually higher, in particular between 1950 and 1980, than what they have been since 1980. I think this policy of very high progressivity in the middle of the 20th century and the second third of the 20th century was largely a success. And this is what allowed a big reduction of inequality without a decline in productivity growth. You know, we used to think of politics as a world where you have the left defending the poor, right defending the rich. I think this is a very naive view. This has always been a very naive view of politics, because politics has always been about a multidimensional conflict on inequality. You have inequality of what? You know, are we talking of inequality of education, inequality of income, inequality of wealth, inequality of gender, inequality in origins, migration trajectories, ratio, etc. So in a way, it's a miracle that we can have a political coalition that is able to put all these dimensions of inequality into a consistent platform. And so this is what happened in the 50s, 60s, which is good, but we should think seriously about how this can happen again. But this is nothing natural in this particular organization of political coalition. So to summarize, my main conclusion on the political side, you know, globalization, migration, with the rise of domestic versus external inequality, and also educational expansion, with the rise of education versus property inequality, have created new multidimensional conflict about inequality leading to a complete collapse of the post-war left versus right party system. So why didn't democracy reduce inequality? Well, the simple answer would be, well, because multidimensional coalitions, as I was just explaining, are complicated. And if you don't have a strong egalitarian internationalist platform with, you know, coordinating progressive taxation at the regional level, if not global level, to finance, you know, better public services for the poor and the middle class, in particular in education. So if you don't have a platform that can convince people that what they have in common is more important than their differences, you know, you should not be surprised if